If you have a Lowe's Advantage card, you can get an extra 5% off every day on items big or small. So you can save an extra 5% on a new coat of paint, updating appliances, replacing the flooring, and even save an extra 5% on little things like cleaning supplies, laundry detergent, and air filters. The big to-dos to the everyday essentials. You get an extra 5% savings every day when you use your Lowe's Advantage card. If you don't have one, apply today. All projects have a starting point. Start with Lowe's. Subject to credit approval and can't be combined with any other credit offers. Exclusions apply. See store for details. U.S. only.
Join us as we explore these unsolved cases, UFO incidents that baffle even the U.S. military. This is Mack Maloney's Military X-Files. And now, here's Mack Maloney.
Hey, good evening, everyone, and welcome to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney in the studio with us tonight, as always. The very famous Juan-Juan is
and,
here.
And a handsome Juan-Juan.
The handsome Juan-Juan now? Yeah. We have to say the handsome Juan-Juan?
Yeah. I believe it's a contract renegotiation.
That's right.
A quick one.
I need a boost of my self-esteem.
Okay, the very handsome Juan-Juan is here.
Hello, everybody.
Okay,
hello,
all right. He's kind of chipper here today. I'm worried about that. And I just realized, now I know the reason why. I had forgotten, and that's how it goes. Also in the studio with us tonight at a disclosed location.
In the secret bunker at the radio program, ready for operations if called during the show.
Commander Cobra is here with us.
Good evening, gentlemen.
In the house.
Good evening, Commander.
Let's get the salute out of the way.
I got to say, 1-1 salute gets better and better each week.
Yeah, you know, because he's...
You know, it makes him more handsome when he does it correctly.
Jesus, man.
Then I'll have to practice it in front of the mirror.
Get a room. Look at... Not only does he salute, do you notice he stands at attention?
Yes,
too,
yes, right?
You know, where I just, I'm fulfilling my,
yeah. I'm used to it.
To be in here with spitting.
Well, that's the difference between, you know, a veteran and someone who's very supportive of the military.
Someone who went to college. Okay, here we go. What are we doing here? Oh, move it up a little bit? How's that?
Okay.
Okay, here we go.
Good.
All right. That was probably in his contract, too.
Thank you, Mac.
Anyway, so here we are. And it's day 45 of the clown crisis.
That's correct. And it keeps getting deeper each day.
And deeper. You know, I should say tonight, Rob Beckhausen is going to be on. And he wrote to me earlier. Apparently, the U.S. military had built this multi-million dollar catamaran years ago.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the Hutus or someone off of Yemen blew it out of the water.
That's amazing. It's a really incredible ship.
Well, it used to be. Now it's in pieces. Yeah.
Off Yemen, huh?
Yeah, they sold it. The U.S. sold it to UAE, and they were using it. And they think they used one of those Iranian, shorter ship missiles, whatever they call them.
Wow, things. That's amazing.
This thing was supposed to be beautiful.
It
was like,
oh, it is. I'm not sure which one it is. There's a couple of those vessels. Their speed is unbelievable. They had one that was a catamaran type design that went from Tasmania, off the coast of Australia, to the States in under, I think it was like 11 or 12 days. They were averaging 40 knots of speed as they came around to do this mission.
How many people does it hold?
It can hold, it was a good-sized ship. It was about a 220, I think, 200 there. I was on one of the early ships, and they started out as ferries. The way they had their thing is the twin hulls.
Mm-hmm.
The center section caused a surface effect capability, and they're able to sit most of the ship out of the water, which is a critical speed. Just amazing.
Well, that's moving 49 knots in 11 days.
Yep.
Anyway, Rob Beckhouse is going to talk to us about that tonight, plus other subjects. We're also going to have on, of course, Switchblade Steve Ward. He's going to finally tell us about that big UFO flap in Wales 20 years ago, you know, the one where they moved the cows from one field to another and no one knows how they did it.
Right. It wasn't with helicopters or drones or anything.
Nothing. Right. Yeah. So we've been trying to get that in for the past few weeks. We'll be talking about that tonight. Also, we have a author on with us tonight. Very mysterious name. Her name is Cammy. Just Cammy. Okay. You know, like people, yep, when they have one, you know, when they're celebrities and they just have one name.
Pretty cool.
Like Madonna.
Madonna,
or
you know. Cher. Cammy. She's going to be on. She co-authored a book about an asylum very close to where you were there, Commander Cobra, a couple weeks ago, very near Dugway Proving Grounds. And apparently this asylum has all kinds of ghost stories and, you know, creepy stuff, whatever. So
yeah, you shared some of the notes there from your call with her. God, it was a skin crawler when I was reading it.
I can't wait to see that story.
So starting off the month of Halloween. Yeah. This is supposed to be good, and a lot of them have ties in because there was an asylum for military people who worked out there in those secret programs. So
yeah, and maybe not always they were crazy when they went there, but they left that way.
They left crazy, sure. Yeah. So they did the job well. And then, let's see, is that it, Juan-Juan?
Clowns?
Clowns, yes. Well, the clowns.
Clowns, yeah, that's our perennial stuff. Okay. I'm telling you, the...
What's the latest on the clowns? I know that they arrested a couple guys over the last week. Yeah,
so driving into the studio tonight, Juan-Juan and I both heard various reports coming on. It's all over the local news here in the greater New England area. It's spread to a number of states and communities, and there's a ban apparently that's being put out in the state of Connecticut that there'll be no clown costumes at the schools as part of any Halloween celebration, which aside, I can't even imagine that they still even do Halloween celebrations with all the political correctness we have going on these days. But there's that
going
on.
And the safety issues involved.
Yeah, and of course, the safety issues involved. So I did a quick look back, and it's apparent that in France in 2014, there was a ban that was put in France because of, quote-unquote, hooligan clown activities that went on that caused there was some attacks. There was the same kind of paranoia. It only begs to ask the question, you know, where does this nonsense or this phenomenon begin or end? But now... a major journalistic power has entered into the fray. I can't say all the words that's in the article because it's Rolling Stone has stepped in.
You're kidding.
Stepped up, and they have the killer clown inside the terrifying hoax sweeping America. It's a great article.
Okay. So they have a point of view on it right off the bat.
Yeah, they do. And I think they were pretty solid when they were doing the report.
Did they give the Clown Crisis like 3.5 stars or something like that?
I didn't see the rating they put on because this is the online, and I don't buy the publication. I only check it when it's available online. But I have to give them kudos. They did a good job with the article. They talk about all the stuff that's gone on. They have some classic Rolling Stone lines that they just can't help.
About clowns?
Yeah, well, yeah, case in point. And in 5 weeks since clowns popped up in Greenville, the pandemic has spread. So they've got it too. Pandemic, terror hoax sweeping the country. But is it a hoax? That's the question. Is this terrifying? If you're terrified, is it a hoax? Are the clowns killer clowns?
Apparently not, because people are getting injured or there have been attacks in various places. So
another classic. Yeah. I never run, but I turn and ran back to my home as fast as I can. This was Reynolds, a woman that was walking her dog and saw the clown, and she booked for the house. Florida, a hotbed for weird S-H-I-T, because we can't say the word, but we can spell it.
Say the least.
Also had reports of creepy clown sightings in Pensacola and Gainesville. Wow. So,
well, you have to understand there's a lot of red hair and purple hair down there, too, so sometimes they get mixed up.
So North Carolina probably has the most serious one, where they had a machete-wielding clown, and that story was verified, and tried to lure a woman into a wooded area in Forsyth. So I'm not sure how you lure somebody with a machete. I'd be curious to get the details on that.
Right.
And then Winston-Salem has done the increased police presence, and they have made a number of arrests for hoaxes, people that have been throwing this in. I'm telling you right now, mark my words, between now and the show at the end of this month, with Halloween as the culmination, mm-hmm. there's going to be a dead clown.
Yes, there'll be a dead clown.
There's going to be a dead clown. And I cannot imagine how there isn't a dead clown. And if you want to talk gun control, these are states that are primarily pretty straight up with their gun rights. No dead clowns. So I'm going to tell you right now, I will make a political statement. If it is in a gun-free zone that a clown is killed, I am going to wave the banner on this one.
Well, I'll make the second part of that prediction, that you'll see a Clown Lives Matter rally within hours of that incident.
Oh, yeah. Clown Lives Matter, of course.
All clowns matter.
Oh, see, and once again, ba-boom. Two things. First of all, I got a new name for my band, which would be Hooligan Clown Activity. Is that what it was?
Hooligan Clown Activity.
Hooligan Clown Activity. Man, what a name for a group.
HCA, man. Did you hear what they put out? HCA. Hooligan Clown Activity.
I'd register that domain name right away.
Yeah, right away.
And then you can have that sound at the end of it.
That's everything. An echo. It'd be excellent.
Want the sound on the synthesizer. That's what you need.
Here's the thing that just blows my mind. We talked about it last week. Is that if you're going to go out and, let's say, be a hooligan, let's say, all right? I mean, you just get up and you put on your jeans, your shirt, your hat.
Get your Louisville Slugger baseball bat.
And you go. And you're out the door in 2 minutes.
And maybe man up or woman up with maybe a leather jacket. That seems to have the look. Boots.
Right.
Boots, good.
Boots.
But oversized shoes, orange nose, sinister paint on your face.
The time it takes to become a clown, it's like hours. So you have to sit there and you go,
I'm amazed that Mack is...
What am I doing tonight?
I thought Mack was more
open. He's all checked out on it.
No, I thought Mack was more open to the lifestyle. I thought he was more... I thought he had a bigger, broader view. But obviously now, it takes a lot of time to be ready to be a clown.
Well, it does. It does. It isn't like you're saying, okay, come on, let's get the gun, let's get the switchblade, let's go out and terrorize some people. It's a 2 or 3 minute decision at the most, all right? This one, you have to get up, you need all the stuff, you need the hair, you need the big shoes.
True.
And you have to sit there and you got to become the clown. You can't just put it together in a matter of minutes.
No,
it's a matter of hours.
It can't be a spur of the moment kind of thing.
Right. And so that's what I mean, is that you're sitting there that whole time, and any kind of feeling you had 2 hours ago, you probably don't have now, and you're going, I'm getting dressed up as a clown to go out and terrorize people. It just doesn't make sense to me. Why go through all that preparation? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm going to just
close.
Takes
the buzz off of
it. I'm just going to close with the reports out of Pennsylvania from this article, where they talk about Pennsylvania rife with these reports. Pottsville, there was a report of two people wearing clown-like clothes. Now it's not even clowns. They were clown-like clothes. There's a very strong...
Which means what?
Who knows? Driving
around the neck big buttons.
Is the puppy shirt of Seinfeld fame? Yeah. Is that with the proper accoutrements?
Clowns, I think of Pilacci because of my Italian background.
Well, there you go. And then in Edinburgh, a woman caught a peeping Tom clown peering through her window. You knew that was coming, the sexual perversion angle of the clown incident. York College sent out a safety alert on the campus, a reaction deemed necessary after receiving 8 different clown reports in September 24th. And more sightings have been seen and reported in Virginia, Ohio, and most recently in New York State.
Now, did you say clown-like clothes?
Clown-like clothes was the report. And, of course, that doesn't have a lot of explanation what's going on there. I do, I'm not much of a slave to fashion myself, but
Juan-Juan
I am checking myself twice. Well, of course, he's a very handsome man, so he would be the one to be make the determination.
Juan-Juan, oh my God.
Although I think the socks might be in the clown category, I'm not sure. He just showed us our socks on the camera. It was pretty frightening.
Red Argyle socks.
Oh, sorry. 1205.
Hey, I'm a Red Sox fan. What do you want from me?
Oh, that's right, yeah, I guess. Wow, that was stunning right there, to tell you the truth. So what would, Juan-Juan, what would clown-like clothes be? I mean, a big...
The big spots on the
big
front.
Big spots, right, yeah.
Very puffy, blousy, you know, the MC Hammer kind of look, but with ruffles around the neck.
Right.
And what else?
I don't think the shoes can be that big. I think, you should probably just wear regular shoes.
You got to be kind of... Bozo-ish, you know.
Bozo-ish, but not bozo.
You can't walk in them. You just can stand there and be funny in them.
So here's the final piece.
Okay.
Many states are putting out, I'm not sure I guess it's going to be a law or it's going to be an instruction that says, if you're over 16 years of age, you're not to wear this clothing. Wearing a mask and a hood.
So
it'd
be a fine or something, right? Or was a suggestion?
This is with the intent of intimidation or harassment.
Wow.
A solution to the phantom clown resurgent remains unknown.
What is going on here? Does anyone have a what is going on? Is it just a media kind of fuels these things?
I think it got a life of its own. Obviously, the times are very charged with the political atmosphere we're in. The world has gone to hell in a handbasket. If that's stock and trade for us almost every week as we talk about, you know, Syria, Iraq, the Mideast, everything that's going on. I just think that this is one of those things that has a core reaction to so many people. More people tell me now than I ever heard before. The guttural reaction is clowns creep me out in some part.
Mm.
And I do have to throw in my one measure that the killer clowns from space thing, wow. We can't completely disavow the alien nature of this that could be there. And I believe that B movie has some merit in this discussion.
Mm.
I think it's also a social statement on the presidential election.
It could be.
Clowns,
politicians in general.
Go, what a bunch of...
Maybe we're living in the clown era. You know, the clown era. Yep. The era of clowns. Wow. When 10 years from now or 1,000 years from now, when they kind of look back on this, they'll say, and among all the other things these people are going through in 2016.
Yeah, the nuclear trigger being tickled and all that. They had a clown scare.
They had a clown pandemic.
Not clown.
And a major publication called it a pandemic. And people will be sitting there 1,000 years from now in their Jetson homes going, what are they talking about? What kind of happen?
Go to the super internet and tell us what it is. What is the clown pandemic?
Okay. Wow. Something is happening here that's never happened before.
It could be a clown calling us on the station line.
But we're pre-recorded.
I know. So how does that work? Alien clowns would know that we're in here.
We've done this show so many times in the studio. There's a phone here for the first time ever. It just rang. Wow. Maybe it's Batman or the commissioner. Just answer it.
The handsome man can't quite handle the phone, apparently, in your space. That's why there's no phones in the bunker.
Wow. Okay.
Just the light to tell me it's time to go.
Well, very interesting clown report there. We should call that the Big Shoe Report.
The Big Shoe.
Okay. It's happening again. Pick it up. Let's see what happens in a moment.
Hello.
This is very exciting. Oh, yes.
Yes, it is.
Great bit for radio.
Radio is pictures, and we're painting a hell of a portrait here.
Can you call during the day, please? we're recording a program, and we better off. That's okay.
Okay.
That is handsome. Yes. That is handsome Juan-Juan telling somebody, don't call me again.
Yeah, right.
Don't bother me.
Wow.
Did that go on the air?
Yes, it was.
Was it a clown? Did you determine if it was a clown?
Did you hear a little thing in the background? Beep. Oh.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you over your squeaking nose.
Yeah. A little car squealing away from the curb snow with 40 clowns in it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whatever.
Okay, so we're off to quite a beginning here. Why don't we do this? Why don't we listen to our first ad, and we'll come back to our first segment, actually our second segment. This is Mack Maloney's Meal to the Exile Show. Juan-Juan and Command Cobra in the house. We'll be right back after this.
UFOs are found in Renaissance art, on ancient coins, and etched on cave walls. They're even reported in the Bible. But more surprising is when UFOs are seen the most in times of war. Through centuries, thousands of UFO sightings have been made by high-ranking officials, military pilots, and ordinary soldiers. Often, these fantastic appearances occur at the height of great battles. From World War I to D-Day to Korea, Vietnam, and beyond, military investigators are baffled. Why do UFO sightings spike so drastically during wartime? Could it be mistaken aircraft, or is someone or something looking in on us? In UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, Mack Maloney chronicles centuries of these incredible sightings and tries to solve the puzzle of why so many UFOs are seen while humanity is at war. Read about the scare ships, the ghost planes, and the ghost rockets, alien giants in the jungles of Vietnam, UFOs controlling our ICBM bases, dogfights with flying saucers during the Gulf War, and more. 300 pages of unbelievable stories, along with many startling photographs. That's UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, by Mack Maloney, on sale at your local bookstore or on Amazon.com.
Everyone to Mack Maloney's Military Exile Show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney in the studio with us tonight. The very famous Juan-Juan is here.
Hello, Mack. How are you doing tonight?
All equally famous Commander Cobra.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening, Commander.
Last week, before the show, we were yucking it up.
Well, you were yucking up, and you were yucking up that I want to tell you something, Commander Cobra, but I can't.
You couldn't
know,
get
like
a word
three,
in.
Like three times, he wasn't cleared to pass this story.
Wow. Holy cow. So anyway.
I left wondering. As many security clearances as I have, I couldn't get this.
If you have a Lowe's Advantage card, you can get an extra 5% off every day on items big or small. So you can save an extra 5% on a new coat of paint, updating appliances, replacing the flooring, and even save an extra 5% on little things like cleaning supplies, laundry detergent, and air filters. The big to-dos to the everyday essentials. You get an extra 5% savings every day when you use your Lowe's Advantage card. If you don't have one, apply today. All projects have a starting point. Start with Lowe's. Subject to credit approval and can't be combined with any other credit offers. Exclusions apply. See store for details. U.S. only.
Story right. Last week.
So let me start it off this way. Okay, someone who will remain nameless, but who we all know and is very close to working with the intelligence services of this country, okay, told me this incredible story. And again, when I think of it now, still, I laugh about it, but I don't know why I'm laughing about it. So here's the story. I hope you enjoy it, okay?
With an open mind, I'm ready to receive.
Our friend, we'll call him our friend, during the course of his work, was told to go to Washington, D.C. to attend this training seminar, they called them. And he does this often. It's usually in some kind of secure location. And the people involved, they have representatives from the State Department, from the scientific community, the engineering community, special ops, cleared contractors, you know, it's just people from Boeing and stuff who have high, you know, security clearances. And you put together all these people in a room, and you have a guy who's breathing on the microphone.
Could be me. Sorry.
Okay. And you have someone who's running this, and what this person does is they give this crowd of people a problem, okay, and they tell them to break up into their own sections and then come back, and the answer to the problem is you ask three questions. You come back to the moderator.
So it's a brainstorming exercise.
Yes, exactly, right.
Break everybody up in teams? And
yes, in your little groups or skill sets, I'm sure they call them, okay? And these are the people who, you know, the military people are, if not generals, then, you know, colonels and stuff like that. The State Department people, you know, probably
senior
assistants.
GS.
Yeah, right, something like that. You know? It's just a big deal. Lasts an entire weekend. Now, as our friend explained it to me, he said that, you know, a typical question would be, you know, there's been a hurricane in Puerto Rico. We have to, you know, get supplies and food down to the people. How are we going to do that? Okay, the Navy, you how are you going to get the ships? State Department, you get the food. Special Forces usually could. You know, everyone kind of teams
ships up. In and works out the logistics
right.
And the plan.
Right, you know, because you have to go to a ship guy. You have to go to a food right. guy, you know, it just doesn't appear. Okay. So they're now all these people are sitting in this amphitheater. There's, I think he said, about 300 of them. This guy comes out and he says, our problem today is the U.S. government has found an extraterrestrial craft.
No way. Really? That was the question?
Yeah. Ding, everyone went, and 2 weeks ago, and that's what we're going to be working on. So our friend and his little contingent, and everyone was like, wow, this is very strange.
I just have to interrupt you very quickly. I feel very proud that our friend has had so many night classes with us on this particular subject that he could be a star pupil at this gathering. I'm sorry, no more commentary till the end.
So anyway, they go through this exercise, and again, it's you. After you've heard all the data, you break up into groups. And as a group, you come back, I think, in a few hours or something. and you make a presentation that's like 20 pages long, okay? So off they go, and then they come back. And, you know, I don't know who went first, but let's say the scientists went first, okay? And they go up, and there's a panel of them, you know, their speeches, their scripts and stuff.
Right? I'm sorry, I got to just say, I'm thinking Big Bang Theory kind of situation.
Yes, right, yeah. Exactly, you know? And they want to know, you know, what's the surface made of? What, you know, what was the heat differential when it came, you know, and that stuff. Our friend said one of the questions one of the scientists asked is, can I lick it? Can I lick it? In other words, you know, what would happen? You know, is it smooth? Is it?
Definitely Big Bang Theory if someone wants to lick it. Okay.
Goes on and on and on, right? The engineers get up, and they're very interested in the propulsion unit. You know, what's the fuel? What's it seem to get its power from? They have graphs, diagrams. State Department people get up, and what they want to know is, you know, their first question. Now, they're asking these all in questions, okay? You know, have we determined that they're friendly?
Does he have a passport?
Obviously not in style anymore, so you can just kill that, Juan-Juan. Jeepers.
I thought it was still important.
Are you a refugee would be the proper way to phrase that question.
Juan-Juan. Okay.
Let me see your papers.
So they go through, and this thing is going on and on. So then the military contingent gets up, and this one gets me. Okay. The guy just gets up, goes to the microphone, and goes, question number one, what are the weapons? Question number two, how do they work? Question number three, how can we use them? And walk off the stage.
Bada bing. Bada boom.
That's good.
And
that's good.
And all I can think of is, that is funny, but that's what would happen. That's exactly what would happen.
You have just described the cross-section of the government right there in these groups.
Mm-hmm.
And the questions are absolutely spot on. In fact, if you had given me this as an assignment, I would have liked to have seen how close I could have got to what the questions were after this whole setup. Yeah. And I bet you that last group, because of my close kinship with the military community, would have been, yeah. So
then after all this, there's a coda to the story. After all this, they go through all the presentations, and the person running it says, okay, you know, we got three more questions we want you just to mull over. Now that you've gone through all this, okay, number one, would you tell the public that you have found this thing? They've had it for 2 weeks. Have you tell the public?
Now we're getting nasty with that question.
We found the craft, and we're going through it to see, you know, where it came from.
Right.
Number two, would you just tell them we found a craft and that's it? Number three, would you not say anything at all? Okay. In this, basically, subsection of the foundation of what goes on down there, overwhelming majority say nothing. Say absolutely nothing. And my friend said that a young woman from the State Department got up. You know, he emphasized young woman and, let's say, an attractive woman got up. And she said, no,
you did say State Department, so we understand.
She says, no, wait a minute. Wouldn't we go and tell the president, and then the president would tell us what to do? And the guy turned around to her, and here comes the edit. He turned around to her and said, fuck no.
Time check, 7:39.
7:39. He says, no. He goes, people have to realize those people are in office for 4 years, maybe 8 years. You know, we're talking about something that's going to be forever. And a lot of defense contracts are like that. And apparently there is a clearance that presidents don't automatically get, and that's what they're talking about. So there you go. So number one, they wouldn't tell us, but the military would be very interested in the weapons, and I'm sure the defense contractors would too. But it's just it's a little peek into what's going on down there, and they're still kind of wondering, why did they use this as a problem, you know? And as our friend said, the phrase is looking for a pulse, just to see how people would react to something like that, you know?
Any follow-up on that game?
No. This was very recently. Very recently. But, you know, sometimes you throw up a trial balloon just so, you know, you don't get surprised. So.
Or a trial, you know, alien spacecraft.
It's just funny that they would use that of all the examples. He thought it was very unusual that they used something
considering
like that.
Considering the current slate of events and activities that are going on, nukes in Iran, Russians dropping bombs in Aleppo, for the Johnson campaign, that's the country in Syria. Iraq. We're deploying troops to Iraq, and we're not. There's one, you know, that could have been a fun one. How do we break this to the press and to the public? You know, I read the other night that on one of the touch lines, one of the chat rooms, a number of leaves are being canceled between now and the end of December for the military.
Really?
Yeah. Not unusual that would come up, but with all the other stuff that's going on, mm-hmm. yeah, you know, in this political atmosphere, everything is just a charged event. Mm-hmm. Everything has a either positive or negative charge. There's nothing neutral right now when you pick it up.
But
the alien spacecraft problem is a good one.
There was a story on the news the other day, in this one particular day about a week and a half ago, United States military airplanes bombed 6 different countries all in one day. Right. They're all Muslim countries. Mm.
Yep.
So isn't it fun that we're still over there? We're still over there, Commander.
Who said war is boring?
We're still over there, and we're over there now more than we ever were before. Wow. And the reason that we didn't stay on the beginning part when we had a pretty good lid on this mess was because we didn't have a status of force agreement. And this is what I am terrified. Who's the poor kid, person, male, female, crew, whatever, that gets caught in a shoot down or an overrun situation and that hits? Holy crap.
Then what? You know, then what? That's what I always thought that
we're in such a mess right now. I will say one thing that I did see that was very, I thought, uplifting. A young Iraqi woman that came to the States as a refugee from Iraq in the last 10 years. She became a naturalized citizen. She's a Marine, and she's going back with the Marines to Iraq.
Oh, really? Yeah. Is she a Desert 2? No. What did they call
From the picture I saw, Mac, she was a downtown local 9. Easy. No,
really? Yeah.
Wow. I've seen very
downtown Baghdad.
I gotta say, I've seen very few unattractive female Marines. They are in great shape. They have a great attitude, outlook. They're a good-looking group of women.
Wow. You know what? Someone sent me a picture once of the Israeli Women's Defense
Another
Force.
Group of not
oh my
unattractive
God,
they're women.
All like friggin' models.
Yeah, they're very, very.
Is that part of the plan?
And they're very fit.
I'm hot. I mean, they're beautiful.
It could be part of the recruitment campaign,
yeah,
too.
They were like the Dallas Cheerleaders.
You don't have to recruit when everybody's got to serve. They don't spend
everyone
a lot of money
go.
On
it. Oh, that's
that.
True. Yeah, right, right.
So anyway, hey, listen, that's my story about what's going on.
That was a good one.
From our good friend.
And it was worth.
I think it's just a look deep into what is really going on down there and what would happen.
A friend of the show who cannot be named.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Very close to the action. Anyway, hey, listen, why don't we take an ad now, and we'll be back right after this. You're listening to Mack Maloney's Military Ask File Show on the Distant Thunder Radio Network.
America has lost World War III. Terrorists control the countryside. Air pirates rule our skies. The United States is no more. But just when it seems like freedom is a thing of the past, a new hero emerges from the ashes. A true American who stands up for what's right. A fighter pilot who can defeat any foe, anytime, anywhere. He is the Wingman. Follow the adventures of Hawk Hunter, the Wingman, as he fights to revive the idea of America. Through 17 action-packed books, Hunter battles all those who would tread on old glory. In the air, on the sea, or on the ground, his dream is to put the United States back together again, or die trying. For some of the greatest aerial action you'll ever experience, strap in and hold on. Wingman by Mack Maloney. Now available for Kindles and Nooks on Amazon.com.
UFOs are found in Renaissance art, on ancient coins, and etched on cave walls. They're even reported in the Bible. But more surprising is when UFOs are seen the most, in times of war. Through centuries, thousands of UFO sightings have been made by high-ranking officials, military pilots, and ordinary soldiers. Often, these fantastic appearances occur at the height of great battles. From World War I to D-Day to Korea, Vietnam, and beyond, military investigators are baffled. Why do UFO sightings spike so drastically during wartime? Could it be mistaken aircraft,
or is someone or something looking in on us? In UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, Mack Maloney chronicles centuries of these incredible sightings and tries to solve the puzzle of why so many UFOs are seen while humanity is at war. Read about the scare ships, the ghost planes, and the ghost rockets, alien giants in the jungles of Vietnam, UFOs controlling our ICBM bases, dogfights with flying saucers during the Gulf War, and more. 300 pages of unbelievable stories, along with many startling photographs. That's UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, by Mack Maloney. On sale at your local bookstore or on Amazon.com.
Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney. In the studio with us tonight, the very famous Juan-Juan is here.
Hello, Mack.
Looking handsome and rather dapper for
Thank
some
you.
Reason.
Thank you.
Also looking, you know, I don't know if he's dapper or not, is Commander Cobra is in the house with us tonight.
Good evening, gentlemen. Definitely not dapper.
Nope. He brought me a 7-iron today. Thank you very much.
And who's going to get hit with it?
Probably me or some clown. Anyway.
On this, boom.
On the phone with us, calling us from the murder capital of the planet, if not the United States, a good friend, Rob Beckhausen, down there in Dallas, Texas. How are you doing there tonight, Rob?
Hey, I'm pretty good.
Are you still voting for Trump?
Well, no, oh, wait. When was it established that I was?
Like about 2 or 3 weeks ago, you said, I'm going to support him. You were in Trump country.
I don't recall.
Let me just very quickly just point out in a little minute way how I know that he is not the guy for this country. Okay? And his, I'll tell you, the commander is getting into pounce position, I can tell.
Me too.
It's just a little, and I'm not going to talk politics or anything. I'm just saying. If someone is running for the president of this country, they should know this little piece of information. They got it completely wrong. When he was in the first debate, he is always talking about how the military in this country sucks, which is wrong to begin with, but he's running for office. So
that's not what he said. But
I will give him that much. But he gave one of the examples of how our military supposedly is in a
decline.
He says B-52s have been flying around for 60 years before, you know, the parents of the people flying them around. And he looked at that thing as a negative thing. Now, anyone you know, Commander, anyone who is a military advisor to anyone would tell him it's the complete opposite. The B-52 is revered as one of the greatest airplanes ever. And the fact is that they've been able to keep it flying because it keeps adapting to new stuff. It's
right.
It's the taxpayer's best dream. And it's something that, you know, it's a symbol of our power. There isn't someone on his staff who can, you know what I mean?
Somebody should have checked that out.
I actually agree with his premise, though. I'm sorry, the B-52 is a great airplane, and the people that are flying it are the grandchildren, the people that saw it when it first came out. It is a great airplane that can be continually rebuilt, but this country has fallen woefully behind.
Okay, but all right, if you use another example.
You're right. You shouldn't use the B-52.
Am I right there, Rob Beckhausen? Have I changed your mind? You going to vote for Hillary now?
Well, the B-52 has been around for a while. It's a really rugged, tough, reliable airplane.
Like,
but
it is old,
and the Pentagon wants to replace it.
See, because you can't hear him,
I can hear him. I heard that loud and clear. Okay. He didn't answer your question.
Well, I'm wary of making political endorsements. As a reporter. So.
Down there, they might. Who knows what you do down in Dallas when you're... So listen, so what's going on down there this week?
Have you seen any clowns, Rob?
Well, you know, actually, there was in the news just today that there was a creepy clown sighting with a baseball bat in a park in the Dallas area.
Okay. And it sounds like the hooligan clown description from an earlier part of the show.
Excellent. He shows up at the ballpark with a bat.
Well, he apparently confronted a guy, and the guy kicked his ass. And he had MMA training.
Perfect. All right. That's the funniest thing about it is that the guy, you know, was probably 2 weeks ago before this whole clown thing began. It was, he's proving my point. This is a guy who would just get dressed up in regular clothes, go out with a bat and try to, you know, hooligan somebody. This time he got dressed up as a clown and got his ass kicked, man. That's the cosmos sending you a message.
It's a bad idea all around.
Yeah, just, really.
If you're out there and you're considering
dressing
up for whatever
reason. So another dimension has been identified by Mac. We have clown karma to now add to the...
Clown karma. Exactly.
So the question will be a public service announcement on TV. Do not dress your children as clowns.
Yeah, because as we were talking about earlier, they've actually banned clown costumes in a lot of like schools and places across the country. You know. Now we were talking off here earlier today, and you brought up this story about this catamaran. Okay, could you explain to people what it was first, and then tell everyone what's been happening with it recently?
So, yeah, there was a ship called the HSV-2 Swift. We just call it the Swift, which was a hybrid catamaran, a boat that was built by an Australian company and leased to the United States Navy between 2003 and 2013. And it's a light aluminum hull, all aluminum, experimental vessel that the Navy, you know, they wanted to try out this.
If you have a Lowe's Advantage card, you can get an extra 5% off every day on items big or small. So you can save an extra 5% on a new coat of paint, updating appliances, replacing the flooring, and even save an extra 5% on little things like cleaning supplies, laundry detergent, and air filters. The big to-dos to the everyday essentials. You get an extra 5% savings every day when you use your Lowe's Advantage card. If you don't have one, apply today. All projects have a starting point. Start with Lowe's. Subject to credit approval and can't be combined with any other credit offers. Exclusions apply. See store for details. U.S. only.
Ship, because they were developing ships that we know today as the littoral combat ship.
Oh, right. And close into shore type.
Yeah,
stuff, right?
The idea is that you move quickly, you get close to shore, you could launch commandos from it, helicopters.
Mm-hmm. And it has two hulls and so on, right?
Right. So it's two hulls that are in one vessel.
They're great ships.
Yeah,
Juan
has just shown me a picture of it. It's a substantial warship.
Oh yeah, yeah. It's
gray and yeah. Right, I thought there'd be something like with Duran Duran hanging.
No, no. It's a high speed
Viking cruises.
Yeah.
It was designed for high speed movement, mm-hmm. and it was a ferry company that was built them in Tasmania. And when I was on my icebreaker last century, we pulled in. They were there, and they had their. It was their first one was all painted to look like a Tasmanian devil. The whole nice. Side of it was actually pretty.
Excellent.
And I went over, and of course we ended up having drinks, and then I went out and took a ride with them the following day after we had sobered up. I just make sure we get that note in there.
All right, for the record.
Duly noted.
So now this thing was in the U.S. Navy had a couple of these ships?
Right, had a couple. The Swift was leased to the Navy, and it had at various times the crew would be a mixed civilian contractors and Navy personnel. And again, it was designed as a test bed. You know, we're gonna test out this concept of ships.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Navy was also looking at future war being closer to shore. It's changed a bit now. Anyhow,
it looks like to me with this vehicle you could be at war and be on vacation.
Yeah,
at the same time.
Yeah. It looks like Saudi prince would have. You know, except
the first
painted
one,
gray.
Yeah, it's painted except painted gray. Right, the first one. There was another one. I forget the name of it, but it was. It's now a cargo. It's now a car ferry in the Irish Sea.
Oh.
So, but yep. the Swift was, the Navy in 2003 got rid of it, and it was then leased to a company in the United Arab Emirates, which is so okay. So the most recent news is that the Houthi rebels in Yemen. Blew it up off the coast. So they don't know. See, this we know that it's been attacked, but there's not a lot of information right now. So the UAE is very secretive. There's been some anonymous, Pentagon sources that have claimed it was heavily damaged but not sunk.
Mm-hmm.
So this is an ex-Navy experimental ship that was pretty badly, you know, banged up.
Right.
Just the other day, it was a Saturday morning.
Just explain who these Hutu characters, not the Hutus, isn't that the Hutus? Who are they in Yemen again? They're the Hutu
Hutus are the ones that are aligned with Iran in Yemen.
Aligned with Iran and Yemen, and they're fighting Saudi Arabia and the UAE.
Right.
That's right. I mean, it's very complicated. Not even experts agree that nobody really knows what's going on there. Even Yemenis are confused. And
perfect.
Don't know
let's go to war. We're confused. We're a little confused about who we're fighting.
Which side we want to be on. Right.
But, so we'll have to update the expression.
It's a Saudi-Iranian proxy war, to put it simply.
Got it. Okay.
And, yes.
Wow. And the Houthis are backed by Iran. They don't know what they. I mean, they released a video of the ship blowing up, and it was pretty catastrophic. The vessel on fire at night, but it was visible enough that you could make out the distinctive shape of the hull.
So this was a UAE military crew involved on board. Maybe
We don't know. I mean, it was contracted to a company in the UAE, so it may have It could have had civilian crew on board. There's no word on anybody injured or killed.
Right.
According to the UAE military that was transporting humanitarian supplies.
Well, I'm sure now, it was.
The UAE has...
There's the catchword, Commander Cobra. The humanitarian supplies, a contract company out of the UAE.
Yeah. Say no more, really.
Okay, so what three-letter agency is not going to be mentioned tonight was behind the movement of a high-speed ferry-type boat going into a war zone where we have both sides, and we are basically playing nice on both sides.
Right.
We're blocking for the Saudis on one side with the taking them to court, and we're being nice to the Iranians. I guarantee you, you're going to find something from Langley, Virginia on this one.
Or in that area code, for sure.
interesting, isn't it?
Well, and it's funny that, you know, these guys, these Hutus, Hulis, whatever the hell they are, running around in Yemen, which is the poorest state, if not in the world, in that part of the world.
Well, I think Somalia and Ethiopia, just on the other side, could give them a pretty good run for their money. But it's sort of like the Mississippi, Louisiana, who's last in education thing going on.
Exactly. Right. You know, and the place is a dump, and you get these people there,
Commander,
running around.
I'm just stating
fighting a war
statistics
that they're confused who they're fighting, and all of a sudden they get a hold of some kind of weaponry at night and hit this baby out there. So. There's some intelligence problem,
and that's what really makes me wonder. The reason a ship like this, so lightly skinned, and how fast it goes, you don't slow this thing down.
These
guys were running these ships at night on NVGs with FLIR going. You know, they were able to move 30, 40 knots at cruise speed at night.
Nice. Yep.
So when you slow
just
down,
don't hit anything.
When you slow down and start playing this game that they're playing. It makes it sound like, to me, a second one of these events where something was supposed to be offloaded and somebody got into it, and it's not humanitarian only that was on board.
Come on. Yeah, that whole humanitarian stuff is... Go ahead, Juan-Juan. Did you have something to say?
No.
Okay.
No, he's upset with me because I made the Louisiana, Mississippi remark, and now he's checking my stats in Vegas.
You know?
I believe that a southern school will feature... in with some other things that Rob wants to bring up tonight.
Really? Okay. Well, he's down south. Go ahead,
and
Rob. So, what else is going on?
Well, a few more notes on this ship. We don't know how the Houthis blew it up exactly. There were some, anonymous Pentagon sources again, who said that they fired a fusillade of rockets, which hit it. There's been some speculation that the rebels might have used something a little more high powered. Some said speculated that a Chinese type missile. Well, there's an Iranian version of the C-802 anti-ship cruise missile. Called the Iranian version is called the Noor, and the Iranians do have pretty strong evidence that they've armed the Houthis. But again, that's just speculation. So, but if they have a high powered missile like that, I mean, this has occurred in the Bab al Mandab Strait, connects the Red Sea to the to the Arabian Sea. It's a very important strategic choke point.
Right.
And so if they're taking ships out in this strait, that's a real problem. And so right now there are two U.S. destroyers that have been scrambled that location right now.
A lot of pirate activity there. And I think the major port there is Aden.
Aden's on one side, is correct.
It's equidistant. It's the exact halfway point between London and some city in Asia. What was the first stop when the British ruled the seas?
Hong Kong?
Maybe Hong Kong. Boy, that seems like a long
way. Or Macau or something like
that? Yeah, something like that. But it was. That's why that is there. There's nothing else in the country, really, but it's a pretty substantial port facility right there. And halfway through, when you were there, you knew you were halfway, you know, to your destination. So, okay, go ahead, Rob.
Well, yeah, also another last point. I mean, this has an aluminum hull, and the melting point's, well, you know, pretty low compared to steel. So this thing burned. Mm. And, you know, this is a problem for the Navy's littoral combat ships now. In case we had to fight China, you know, there was a lot of worries that these ships wouldn't survive. And, you know, we saw this in the Falklands. Mm-hmm. These British ships with a lot of aluminum burned when they were hit by missiles.
The Sheffield was one of them. Mm. Burnt to a crisp.
So,
yeah.
Mm. So there are implications here.
Right. I mean, we've talked about this before, and I still haven't got the definition right. I know that what littoral means, it means close to shore.
Right.
But what kind of conflict are you preparing for that you're close to shore? I don't get it.
So if you need to do boardings where you're not just going to blow everything out of the water, or if you want to have a show of visible strength in there that you want to keep smugglers from moving, or you want not used mines, because mm-hmm. we don't mine at sea. It's, you know, considered not a way to conduct business.
Right.
Although it's a highly effective way to keep people into a port area.
Right.
So a lot of the operations that we are facing, these low intensity, although that seems to have just as much killing going on as anything else,
right,
requires that kind of presence. Well, if you have a big hull ship, it's actually very susceptible now to something like this if you bring it in, because it can't maneuver. It needs deeper water.
Right.
You can't move very fast.
Right.
And now what you want is the ability to move quickly in shallow waters, be able to project power, presence, and mm-hmm. then pull back off when you need to. And that's why they're trying to come up with this class of ship. And frankly, the Navy in our country never had this, because it has a Coast Guard, and the Coast Guard has always been that kind of capability.
Makes sense. Right. Okay. Close. And I get it now. Okay. Interesting. Mm-hmm. I know that none of the ships they're building have turned out too well. They've like changed the design in the middle of, you know, commissioning these things.
The problem is, as I've said, I've used the analogy, anything in the military, we have a nice clean paper design, you build it. Airplane, tank, mm-hmm. Utility vehicle, tactical vehicle, whatever it is.
And then you find a purpose for it.
No. Yes. By the time you get done, everybody and his brother on a committee has to add something on. You have to have this jammer, this missile, this fire protection system, this. Next thing you know, it's overweight. It can't fly the way it was advertised to fly. It can't sail as far as it's supposed to sail. It needs bigger tires than it had before.
It meets none of the original design objectives whatsoever.
There's a great thing online to look up, and it's it talks about what the customer wanted, which is a swing with a tire, and it shows all the different parts of a company and what they perform. Mm-hmm. And it's a great little sketch, and it's what happens with a lot of these military products. Right. And what the problem is, it comes down to economy. You want one thing to do many, many missions.
But I realize, and that's happened. That's plagued them for the past 30 years. They've come out with planes that can do everything. You know, they come out, I guess, with ships that can do everything, like this multi-purpose idea. But if you look back, kind of in military history, Rob, that really never works, does it? And you take away the strengths of like a multi-purpose airplane instead of just giving it one purpose and doing it 100%, right?
Yeah, I mean, just a general rule of engineering, you know, and design is simplicity. Have it do something and do it really well.
Mm-hmm.
That's just a general rule for. It's not even just the military, really.
Right. Right.
You know, if you're going to design a car, you know.
Now, Rob, as you're talking about aircraft, you had another interesting story this past week that I had read more is boring about aircraft and turnovers, and this will help Juan understand my remark on Mississippi and Louisiana.
Okay. Go ahead. Who's talking?
It should be Rob talking about the C-23 transfer.
Which story are you referring to there?
The C-23 transfer.
Oh, Rob. The Sherpa. Yes, right. Great airplane.
Yeah, I can talk about it. Yeah, so we did a story about this the C-23 Sherpa, which is a, it's a, I was not that familiar with the plane, honestly. There's not
very many of them. Yeah, it's built in Ireland. It's from the Short Brothers.
Right, right. And if you want a visual of it, imagine like an RV camper.
I think of a milk carton on its
right.
side.
Yes, with wings.
With wings.
Right. I mean, when you look at it and you go, really? That's the design you came up with? But I know it's a two-engine airplane, has a thin wing, but it can carry a lot of stuff for its size.
Did a hell of a great mission in Iraq. Mm-hmm. The Army flew the Pajeepers out.
And they're tough, right, yeah. Yep, go ahead, Rob.
Well, we discovered that one of these had turned up in northeast Arkansas at Black River Technical College, which is a little small college with around 2,500 students, and that there's a police training program, police academy at the college, that had acquired one of these. And I was like, that's very interesting. And so through the Freedom of Information Act, we found out how the college obtained it. And which was, you know, the story is about, I'll explain, but the story is about the plane itself, but also, you know, this Pentagon to police pipeline.
Oh, right, yes.
You know, equipment and weapons and so on.
Yep.
And how easy it is for police academies and police departments to acquire all kinds of military hardware. And so in this case, Black River Technical College wrote the Defense Logistics Agency a very simple two-paragraph letter.
Jeez.
And they said, okay, fine, here you go. Wow. And
we should
do
that.
The plane, you know, officially is to be used to train law enforcement for, you know, a variety of, you know, counter-narcotics missions and so on.
Right.
But, I mean, this is a pretty controversial item, you know, and there's been some changes recently, you know, tightening the in the government, tightening the rules for you know how police departments get this stuff.
Right.
I'm specifically citing the C-23 as you know, requiring more detailed justification.
It seems like a bad idea for just two paragraphs, you know. And the whole thing too is what's fueling this, if I'm not mistaken, is that there's a lot of surplus stuff coming back from Iraq, like Humvees and stuff like that, you know, that the stuff is available. So if you're the SWAT team in, you know, Podunk somewhere,
skip the Humvee.
I want a tank. And, you know, all these, those buffaloes, I know that some police have those things. Yep. I don't know.
The MRAPs now. Can you get your MRAPs, hand on an MRAP? Yeah, pick up an MRAP. Yeah. That's a styling vehicle there.
You can see police departments becoming
militarized. It's like the Army and Navy store for weapons and vehicles.
Yeah, and I know because I read before. Thank you, Juan-Juan. He was showing us pictures of the Sherpa 123. You know, that it's like two paragraphs, and they will literally send you something that was just in Iraq, you know, a few months ago. So anyway, do they have to give the plane back?
Oh no,
no. And who's flying it? Students?
It's the college. I mean, they didn't respond to our request for information, for questions. So wish I had more information to give you. I mean, there's a little maintenance program at the school that takes care of it.
Right.
But that was in the request. So we know that because it was actually written in the request to the DLA. But what was this? What was this anecdote we were gonna tie this into? What was there was something about Mississippi?
Oh, Mississippi and Louisiana.
Yeah, it was a perfect tie in Arkansas. I took some on the cam here from the bunker room that I do the show from when I'm down.
Yes.
I took the handsome man gave me a bit of a skew look when I made a remark about we were talking about the relative position of Somalia in Yemen and who came in last. Yeah. And I just happened to say, as a metaphorical example, the race to the bottom usually of where we are in the education, public education, and I lived in that part of the world, great people, but Louisiana and Mississippi, right next door to Arkansas, have a bit of a difficulty getting out of the 50 and 49 position.
What you're saying is Louisiana is the Somalia of the United States.
No, I'm saying that it's the
Mississippi.
It's the education rankings, not these.
Right.
If you, my home state of Maine has a better chance of being the Somalia of the United States.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. Nice lobsters, though. So
I'll have to see the data on that.
Handsome man, why were you so upset that he was taking down?
Well, when I think of Louisiana and Tennessee and that part of
I
the country.
I never brought up Tennessee.
Oh,
Louisiana and
what? You think that the jewels of the country, you mean?
You know, you can't disparage the educational level of an entire area, can you?
I guess everybody's a winner in Juan's world, and there's no rankings. Okay, no problem.
I'm okay with rankings.
Yeah, okay. Look it up on your machine. Where are the educational rankings? Oh, no, right. I'll do it for you here in the bunker.
Here we go. We'll share. Oh, man.
Sorry, Rob. I mean, we're in neutral corners now.
Now I have to go in and separate these two guys. You know, you're both going to get hurt if that happens. So, Rob, thanks for that report. So tell us, what is going on down there these days? Give us a glimpse into life in Dallas these days.
Oh, well, I was about education. I mean, I'm a product of Southern schools, and there's a lot to be desired.
What do you mean a product of Southern schools?
Texas schools.
Oh, wow.
That isn't really the South, though, is it?
What is it?
It is. Texas is Southern. I mean, Texans like to believe it isn't because it's, you know, we're different and so on. It's like, no, you're not. This is a relatively recent thing. You know, Texas in the 19th century, you know, Texans were all very much into Southerners, and they looked down on, you know, cowboys as these ruffians, aristocratic, you know, Southerners who wear fancy outfits. And that kind of thing. I mean, it was in the 20th century when that started to change. They said, hey, that's kind of a bad look. We should embrace this Western thing.
So, right.
Rob, I'm just going to break in here real quick with the latest I could pull off. Massachusetts is ranked overall number one.
Really?
In school systems. And Louisiana, and I just want to make sure I add this correctly, on this, they are ranked 49.
Oh,
wow.
And
according to what data?
The internet. It can't be lying.
The funny thing is that they think they're last because they don't know there's 50 states. So, it's no harm, no foul.
And District of Columbia is actually in the 50 slot right now.
Wow. So, who's 51?
51 is New Mexico.
Really? Yeah? Wow. Huh. I didn't think that.
Mississippi, you're doing great. You're at 46.
All right. There you go. Hey.
Where's Texas on that, by the way?
Texas.
Yeah, whatever, handsome man.
What's?
I'm working on Texas. Let me bring Texas up here. Oh. Texas is 26.
Wow.
No.
Right in the middle.
That's not that bad.
No. Right in the middle. You know?
Is the education level per capita or
no,
intelligence
this is the
level?
Rankings for the states on state public education.
Okay.
Wow.
Compiled by who? The Department of Education?
I don't know.
They come out.
The Teachers Association?
They come out. I see these things every once in a while. They rank them.
I've heard of them too, but...
Of all the things that we've talked about on this show...
He's upset about this.
Yeah. We talked about, a government... A committee, a group, training group gets together and talks.
If you have a Lowe's Advantage card, you can get an extra 5% off every day on items big or small. So you can save an extra 5% on a new coat of paint, updating appliances, replacing the flooring, and even save an extra 5% on little things like cleaning supplies, laundry detergent, and air filters. The big to-dos to the everyday essentials. You get an extra 5% savings every day when you use your Lowe's Advantage card. If you don't have one, apply today. All projects have a starting point. Start with Lowe's. Subject to credit approval and can't be combined with any other credit offers. Exclusions apply. See store for details. U.S. only.
About UFOs.
Yep, and withholding.
And three questions. Nary a peep if we have to see his Argyle socks. I make an offhanded remark to give a metaphor for the audience. And he is not letting this one go.
All right.
What the hell?
What do you have a thing about Louisiana? Did you have like some, affair down there or something?
He was married. Look at.
You've been to New Orleans.
I lived there.
Talk about the murder capital of the
world.
Oh,
my God.
No, I've never been to New Orleans.
Oh, my God. 6 months to get ready for Mardi Gras, 6 months to recover.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and get the bodies off the street.
All right. Okay.
Okay, listen. Hey, Rob, thanks a ton for joining us tonight. We will talk, about the GoPro, the target, the gun range, the chicks and everything. We'll do that.
I'm coming down, Rob. Get ready.
Oh, boy. There you go. You better get ready.
All right. Okay. I'll prepare myself.
Okay.
For this.
And of course, the offer is always to come up here and spend the weekend to see the changing leaves up here.
Yeah, that's right.
Come up for the foliage.
The leaf peepers,
you always have a place to stay up here, and there is a shooting range if you want to warm up on my property.
Join the other 50 million people that are on those New Hampshire roads, man.
Check out the state liquor store up here in New Hampshire.
That's true. I was in one of those the other day.
Firearms and
it's like Walmart.
He's going to have to report that now because he's a resident of Massachusetts that he actually stepped in a liquor store.
I didn't say that I bought anything.
No, you were in it, and you have to be deprogrammed now.
Okay,
it is an awesome place.
So anyway, Rob, thanks for joining us, and we'll talk to you next week. Rob Beckhausen of War is Boring, the best military writing on the internet. War is Boring. WarIsBoring.com. Rob, thank you, and we'll talk to you next week.
See you later, Rob.
See you then.
There you go. Okay, hey, you're listening to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. We'll be right back after this.
After the events of 9/11, we thought America would never be the same. Our homeland was attacked. Our fellow Americans killed by terrorists. It seemed like all hope was lost. Until a special group of patriots came together and defied the Pentagon and vowed to take revenge, but in their own way. They took the battle to the terrorist doorstep, turning the tables on the murderers, fighting with no rules, taking no prisoners, until they became terrorists themselves. This is the story of the Super Hawks, soldiers so secret even the president didn't know they existed. Their mission was to kill Bin Laden, but they wound up saving the world. Super Hawks, a new series for Kindles and Nooks by Mack Maloney, available on Amazon.com.
UFOs are found in Renaissance art, on ancient coins, and etched on cave walls. They are even reported in the Bible. But more surprising is when UFOs are seen the most, in times of war. Through centuries, thousands of UFO sightings have been made by high-ranking officials, military pilots, and ordinary soldiers. Often, these fantastic appearances occur at the height of great battles. From World War I to D-Day to Korea, Vietnam, and beyond, military investigators are baffled. Why do UFO sightings spike so drastically during wartime? Could it be mistaken aircraft, or is someone or something looking in on us? In UFOs in Wartime, What They Didn't Want You to Know, Mack Maloney chronicles centuries of these incredible sightings and tries to solve the puzzle of why so many UFOs are seen while humanity is at war. Read about the scare ships, the ghost planes, and the ghost rockets. Alien giants in the jungles of Vietnam. UFOs controlling our ICBM bases. Dogfights with flying saucers during the Gulf War, and more. 300 pages of unbelievable stories, along with many startling photographs. That's UFOs in Wartime. What They Didn't Want You to Know, by Mack Maloney. On sale at your local bookstore or on Amazon.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney in the studio with us tonight. Very famous and very handsome Juan-Juan.
Thank you. With my red argyle socks.
Right. He's some reason earlier in the show, he demanded that we call him Mr. Handsome tonight.
But, I think it's from here on out.
Right. Yeah. What, a negotiating ploy? Is it a ploy?
It's a new contract requirement with Juan-Juan.
Wow. Anyway, and... Commander Cobra is also here, and we have saluted him already.
Yes, and it was already rated.
Okay, all right.
Let's just move on.
Okay, all right. Well, no.
He said it was getting better.
No, what started was you gave him a great salute. You gave attention, and he complimented you.
It was a more crisp salute.
Right, and I'm just like barely, right. Going up to the...
And then it starts, 10 minutes later. By the way, I want to be referred to as handsome. I mean, it's not... There's something not right there. Let's not go into it. Just move on.
It is out of control here. But anyway, to bring us all back to reality, on the phone with us is our friend Switchblade Steve Ward up there in Battle Creek, Michigan. How are you doing there tonight, there, Switchy?
I am doing really good tonight.
Wow. What was that?
Bomb? Steve reached right through the microphone and pulled my head into it.
Okay. All right. That was like that.
It sounded like a golf ball fell out of his hand.
Anyway, okay. Just more of the fun here on Mack Maloney's Military Exile show. Steve, how are you doing tonight?
Beyond wonderful.
Beyond wonderful. That would be the title of your biography, right? Or your autobiography?
Or my epitaph. What's
Beyond wonderful. Yeah, beyond
all
wonderful.
Three.
He was beyond wonderful. Now he's just beyond. Anyway,
that was a downer on his epitaph. Okay.
Yeah, I know.
Are you writing it already?
Once again,
no.
Someone's sucking the funny right out of the
room. I think that you could also put that right above what W.C. Fields said. I'd rather be here than in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. In W.C. Fields' last film.
Oh, I know this trivia. Keep going.
Who plays the bartender?
Damn, I do know.
It's the one where he says, not the Philadelphia one, but something about kids. He's,
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's, anyway. It's a classic.
Shemp.
Yep. From the
really?
Yeah, Shemp. It was. He's like
Shemp Howard.
Yeah, Shemp Howard. Yep. He's like the second, you know, billing on the movie.
Yep.
Anyway, W.C. Fields drank a little bit. You know that?
I've heard that he tipped a couple in his day.
Anyway, Switch. So let's get back to you. Your biography would be, what was it? Simply
his
Wonderful?
His epitaph.
No, Beyond Wonderful. All
three. Beyond Wonderful.
Beyond Wonderful. Okay.
And then you had to add that he's now beyond.
Anyway. So I was told off air by our staff that you have a clown-related story to start off with.
Well, I just said I had some more information, but
either way,
it preceded the weird clown stuff that was going on. You know, remember we talked about Lauren Coleman, how he found that this stuff was happening all over the U.S., not just in Boston in 81.
Right.
Well, the thing that kind of seemed that, well, and maybe it was connected, maybe not, but at a place called Mineral Point, Wisconsin, in March of that year, an entity that they called the Vampire was running around. This guy had his face was painted all white, not quite like a clown, wore a cape, and was scaring the hell out of people. And it was a little bit like, remember the reports of Spring-Heeled Jack?
Oh, yeah. My favorite monster.
Kind of, there's some vague similarities in some of these things.
Wow.
So I just thought it was interesting that kind of kicked off everything.
If it was a guy in white with a cape running around, I go and arrest every English teacher. And within, you know what I mean? Like, you know, they all have capes, you know that. Within a 30-mile radius.
I just remember back to the days of the KISS Army. Obviously, I'm showing my age. There was quite a bit of that going on. Yeah. So,
I mean,
they made a career out of it. Why can't the man in Wisconsin?
Wow. Well, hey, maybe he's, you know, trying. You never know.
All right. I'm keeping a strict rule. What is your next piece, Steve?
Yes, okay. I'm just fascinated by the fact that people are going out not just to be hooligans, but dressing up as clowns and then being hooligans.
Yeah, now we have clown vampires to add to the clown karma. Perfect. Steve, your next item, please, sir. You had something, the hills. You had an update on the hills that you wanted to talk about in the aftermath.
Well, I thought maybe we could say that for another time. It would take a little bit of time, and there's quite a bit to talk about on the whales story.
Okay.
Promised.
All right. Well, we got to roll.
Go.
Okay.
The name of the place in Wales was?
It's a county. It's actually... it's not there anymore. It's broken up into three different counties. But it was back then in 1977. It was called Dyfed, and it's spelled D-Y-F-E-D. Okay. And these strange events are chronicled in a great book called The Dyfed Enigma by Randall Pugh and F.W. Holliday.
Mm-hmm.
F.W. Holliday was a great researcher into the Loch Ness Monster.
Okay.
His first book chronicled it. He thought it was a flesh and blood animal. His second book, called The Dragon and the Disc, he pursued a paranormal aspect.
Oh,
very
wow.
Interesting.
Yeah, right.
Great researchers.
Hmm.
But what happened here was this particular case, on the surface, it seems like almost like an ET invasion.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of bizarre things going on.
Right.
But everything you can imagine was going on in this area. Poltergeist phenomena, religious apparitions, a strong, what I call, Magonia connection, like, via Jacques Vallée, Passport to Magonia.
Oh, right.
Connections
sure.
with the little people,
yep.
Similarities to that, the folklore. So one of the first events that occurred was around a school.
Excuse me, did we say what year this was and date and everything?
Yes. Yeah, 1977.
Okay, 77,
In southwest Wales.
And the month again was?
A month was February. February the 4th is the first first incident that occurred.
It's dank and rainy and cloudy and miserable and so on.
Go ahead. It's the Broadhaven middle school, and there was kind of a swampy area out back. Now, some of the children, when they're out in recess, they spotted this egg-shaped object in a field. And there were several of them that saw this. So they went in, told the headmaster. Headmaster thought, kids are just playing a prank.
Mm-hmm.
But later on, in the days that followed, other teachers saw this thing in the distance. Now, Randall Pugh, that's spelled P-U-G-H, by the way.
Yes.
He got onto this right away. Now, all the people that they interviewed during these several months were firsthand witnesses. They didn't take any secondhand accounts or whatever. But he went and he interviewed these children. They would, some of them saw some kind of a man, some kind of a humanoid figure near this craft. Now, this is off in the distance. There's kind of a stream and then a swampy field on the other side where you couldn't really drive a vehicle back there. They couldn't have mistaken, you know, something else for being back there.
Right.
Now, one of the children that gave the best description was named Michael Webb. Now, his father, Tim Webb, he was an RAF officer. And so they interviewed him. He was a squadron leader also. His father believed his son implicitly. He said, I absolutely believe him. And he said something very interesting. He said, I think that it has, he said, I've never seen a UFO myself, but I think it has something to do with the supernatural or paranormal.
Hmm.
Now, that's an odd thing for somebody to say back in 1977.
Right.
I mean, people like John Keel and Jacques Vallée had published, and that idea was out there. But, you know, even today, people immediately think, you know, E.T., aliens, and
right.
When we're dealing with material.
Right. When we talk about it on the show a lot, the United Field Theory of the Paranormal.
Unified.
Is it? Unified.
Sorry. And we're really going to see it here in this instance.
And you know, all different kinds, everything, Loch Ness, ghosts, UFOs, all wrapped up in the same thing. I think it'd be fascinating if they could prove that someday. Go ahead, please, Steve.
Now, a few of these children thought they saw some kind of a figure moving around by this egg-shaped craft that landed back in the swamp. Okay, go ahead. Now, in about April is when a lot of things hit the fan. Tuesday, April 19th. In a place called Little Haven. Now, this is right on near the shoreline, near the ocean. And it was at the Haven Fort Hotel and owned by a Mrs. Granville. Now, she had got this hotel up and running for a while. It had a reputation as being haunted.
Yes.
Like a lot of these, you know, UFO sites, there's also the paranormal connection.
Right, yes.
It was supposed to be haunted by a lady in white. That was one of the attractions to this area.
All right.
Well, for a couple nights, she'd been buzzed by some kind of a strange blue light overhead.
Happened. Been there.
And,
done that.
And
go
then,
ahead, please.
And then one night, she hears, she's doing her dishes by the window. She hears a humming noise. Her radio quits. She looks outside and sees a couple figures walking in the distance. She gets her binoculars and she sees these two approximately 7 foot tall humanoids dressed in silver suits. She called them boiler suits, was what her point of reference was.
And what the Harlem Globetrotters, were they? Because they used to wear those silver suits.
The thing is that she described their limbs, their arms and legs as long, almost like a gibbon. So there was something definitely, you know, not just the height, but something definitely strange about these two characters.
Yeah. They did not look like they were from Wales, is what we're really
saying. No, definitely not.
All right, go ahead.
Possibly
and
Harlem.
Then, so the next day, the researchers went out there to check out the area. Now, this may have no connection, but there was an old structure there by the sea. It had, you know, a visible shaft in it, air vents and so forth.
Oh, hang on.
Yes?
Did you say the secret word?
Yes, shaft. Go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Oh, man.
Continue.
It had long been abandoned. Mm-hmm. It turned out it had at one time belonged to the Ministry of Defense. This was one of those bases for the Royal Observer Corps
World
War II.
Yep.
But, of course, long since abandoned and not used. So maybe no connection, but it was just interesting that they found landing marks of some kind of craft in that area as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this place, I mean, this everything was going on in this area. A guy named Searle John. This is also in April. He wakes up early one morning. There's a pulsating orange light outside the window. You know, it's almost like these guys weren't trying to stay hidden. It's like, hey, mm-hmm. we're here. You know, we're shining
right,
lights.
Right, yeah,
in your
we're
windows.
Not hiding.
Come and look at us.
Yep.
So he looks out the window. He sees this classic egg-shaped craft up in the air, kind of moving back and forth like a pendulum. But that's not the weird part. The weird part is one of these 7 foot tall humanoids is standing next to the craft. I say standing mm-hmm. loosely, but suspended in the air as if he has just stepped outside this thing and is completely suspended in the air.
Mm.
Now, I want to make a comparison here. I'm going to go back 10 years earlier, Point Pleasant, West Virginia, in the midst of all the Mothman stuff. John Keel's famous book, obviously, mm-hmm. The Mothman Prophecies.
Right.
He describes an event that happened over the Point Pleasant High School. A woman he calls Mrs. Kelly went to go pick up her children. She looks up in the air, sees an egg-shaped craft. Standing next to it outside is a tall figure dressed in a silver suit. No helmet this time, but humanoid looking with long hair.
Wow.
This character is looking down at her children as they're approaching the car. When she looks up again, he disappears.
Huh.
Now, from her point of view, she looked at it in a completely religious context.
Mm-hmm.
How so?
Just one of the many bizarre things that happened.
She thought it was a miracle. That she thought they were angels or something.
Was an probably, angel, right?
Yeah. I think she looked at it in some kind of an angelic context, maybe looking over her children.
Okay.
Oh wow. Hmm. So, and when was the Mothman? What are the dates of the Mothman?
That was 66, 67.
Okay, and now we're talking about 10 years. But we're talking about something that happened in Wales.
It's 10 years later.
10 years later. Okay, but it's so strange that people see like the exact same things. It happens a lot.
Yep.
It happens a lot. Okay, go ahead, please, Steve.
Now, here we're going to get into some of the what I call the Magonia connection. They interviewed, like I say, they interviewed all kinds of people, first-person accounts. They were talking to a brother and sister that had some kind of a UFO encounter. And it turned out the youngest sister, who was about 8, spoke up and said she had a strange encounter one night, sees the flashing light through the window, looks outside, sees the classic egg-shaped spaceship, but instead of a 7-foot-tall humanoid, there's this tiny man standing on the windowsill with long hair, slanted eyebrows, and a curved nose. Now, what does that sound like?
That's Irish.
Leprechaun.
Okay, go ahead, please.
This is the White family. Their dog started...
I don't think we had to go there, Steve. We understand it's Wales.
Right. What's Wales? Please.
Oh, you mean their last name is White? Is that with the?
We don't know. We'll never know. Okay. Go ahead.
There was a lot of animals were affected by these close encounters. This dog wouldn't sleep alone in the kitchen at night anymore. There was another woman, Mrs. Bassett. She saw some kind of a strange blue flashing light as she's driving home. She described it was kind of surrounded by some kind of an amorphous cloud, okay? When she came home, her 3 Springer Spaniels were nowhere to be found. Hmm. 2 of them eventually showed up. Finally, the third one did. The third one never recovered, would never want to be alone. You'd had to literally drag him, a poor dog named Jasper. You had to drag him outside to actually go outside. So there were many instances they chronicled like this.
Right.
And now things are going to turn a little darker, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Young man named Mark Marsden, age 12. Now, I guess there isn't much to do he lived in a little place, a little village called Herbranston. Mm-hmm. And he and his buddies were out looking for bird's nests. You know, I guess that's what you do in Wales.
Wow, that must be really bored.
Or it could be code.
It could be code for, right, yeah, exactly, for.
If you have a Lowe's Advantage card, you can get an extra 5% off every day on items big or small. So you can save an extra 5% on a new coat of paint, updating appliances, replacing the flooring, and even save an extra 5% on little things like cleaning supplies, laundry detergent, and air filters. The big to-dos to the everyday essentials. You get an extra 5% savings every day when you use your Lowe's Advantage card. If you don't have one, apply today. All projects have a starting point. Start with Lowe's. Subject to credit approval and can't be combined with any other credit offers. Exclusions apply. See store for details. U.S. only.
Out looking for bird nest. Please.
Yes.
Okay. Anyway, so he gets separated from his buddies, and he hears this heavy breathing. You see this 10-foot, or rather 7-foot tall humanoid jumps out of the bushes, dressed again. He called it a boiler suit. Now, in all these cases, nobody ever said anything about a visor. They never saw a face or any facial features.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This thing started chasing him. So he runs to the gate of his farm, turns around, sees this thing has stopped. It's standing right underneath a street light so he gets a really good look at it. Then he hightails it back to the farm, totally freaked out. Pugh and Holiday said this kid was... struck them as being a very hardy kid, not easily frightened. But this kid was just absolutely terrified by what happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then we remember we talked about these things peering in windows.
Right.
A postmaster named Josiah George had one of these guys all of a sudden look in his window.
Wow, that's scary. You know what I mean? I mean, just that kind of element of all of a sudden the thing is looking in at you.
Jean Hubers, her two daughters were pursued, they said, by a green orb. It disappeared into the ground. Okay, things are going to get weirder now. The Ripperston Farm, the Coombs family. They saw these humanoid figures, I guess, a few different times. One night, they saw one of these. They called it a football-shaped object. It was the next day they were cattle farmers. They had 100 cattle locked and tied in the pen. That night, they disappeared and ended up a half mile away at the Broadmoor farm.
That's so weird.
Yeah, now think about
that. In order for that to happen, somebody had to come in, unlatch the gate, run them by the house, and this wasn't a straight shot to the farm, like they would just wander off by themselves.
Right.
They actually had to go off at a 90-degree angle to get there.
And how many cows were there?
In this particular instance, 100.
Okay, so you would hear 100 cows going by your
house. Oh, absolutely.
What are aliens trying to say? If you're an alien and you're moving cows a half a mile.
You're saying we can be quiet.
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah.
And they have the technology to elevate.
He came up with that answer very quickly, didn't he? That's almost like a little bit too quick.
They're wicked smart.
Yeah, okay.
You know?
Well, according to the researchers, they dug into the past, and there was a legend of dairy maids. They would their goats would get out of their locked pens.
Dairy maids?
Dairy maids, yes, a century ago.
You mean the women who like actually milk the cows?
Yes, that would be virginal girls milking cows and goats.
Come on.
And the good people, or the little people, would say, our food is being spoiled. So that's why they moved their goats out of there. Pugh and Holliday theorized that they checked. There's a lot of magnetic anomalies in this area. And they think a lot of this might have to do with electromagnetic fields.
Right.
And their hypothesis was that food might have been something to do with the energy supplied at some of these spots. I mean, they're just going out on a limb, but but it's just interesting that you've got this weird parallel with, you know, traditional folklore and stuff that's going on.
Right. And how long did this whole thing last?
About not even quite a year.
Okay, but it was a pretty active year, though, right? If I remember the story right, I mean, stuff was happening.
Oh, yeah.
All the time. But
they had. Go ahead.
I was going to say, why there? You know what I mean? Why is there anything there that's anything?
I never saw a map of these magnetic fields. They talked a little bit about ley lines, you know, LEY.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, a lot of rumored salt lines, and, you know, there's a lot of ancient stuff that goes on.
Yeah, a lot of ancient stuff over there. There's no doubt.
And
about
the formations.
Point Pleasant, and really, you know, the activity, there's still some things that happen in Point Pleasant, but not to that level. And that this apparently hasn't had that same level. So I don't know why, but there's a tradition of some religious apparitions that happened before this.
Much like the Native American stuff that goes on in the United States, this part of the Isles has a lot of legend and lore that goes on going back to the original Celt and Welsh settlers that were there and the tribes that were living there. It's an amazing spot. And I know a lot of the popular culture kind of B-movies in Britain center around these woods with things like Wakewood and the werewolf movies. There's a lot of stuff that goes on there because it's a very, no pun intended, very fertile ground for this stuff that goes on. And up until just recently, I mean, they talk about the UFO crash in 1974 at Berwyn Mountain like it was an airplane crash. Mm-hmm. I mean, most of the people there don't seem to have a lot of issue talking about it in those terms.
Yeah.
Now, I once had to put together a history of strange things that have gone on in England over the years. And, you know, I was told it was going to be 2 pages. It was like 22 pages. Every kind of weird, strange thing that has ever happened, man, it's happened in England. It's incredible.
And the mix of UFOs, supernatural, the banshees, the leprechauns, the bad ones, the good ones, all that stuff is there. It's just, and it extends all through that region, all the way to Ireland, up north into Scotland. It's
strange.
It's got to be some magnetic fields in the Earth's crust.
Something.
Or, plates shifting together. And
it just seems like the more ancient a place is, like the stranger it is, you know. I mean, you know, people don't think about England as actually being in the Roman Empire for like 300 years.
Mm. Well, that's where the word London comes from, because London is the term that they used for their armory, their fortress. That they
put there. Really? Yeah, that's right. Oh, wow. There's a little British humor for you there, history for you there, Juan-Juan.
He's quite cultured.
He is quite cultured. Yep. Anyway.
By the by.
Switch. So what was the, you know, at the end of the day, what, I mean, did anyone, how can you explain it? But, I mean, it was just such a strange story that all this stuff happened to happen in this one kind of isolated, average place.
Well, I was going to make another a mention of the this displacement. A few days later, they put 16 heifers into a pen because they wanted to get the milk machines ready. Left them for 4 minutes.
I've seen this movie. Really?
They were gone completely. They just weren't in some other location.
Well, they went again to the Broadmoor farm. Okay. They were displaced to that one area.
Wow.
Pauline Combs, the woman that on this farm, before they moved there, they were living in just a trailer, and they saw a religious apparition of a woman dressed in white with a veil like a nun. Okay. Carrying a rosary. This is up in the air. She transforms into a vision of Jesus. This happens several nights in a row, seen by hundreds of people. And they're experiencing poltergeist phenomena in their trailer.
Wow.
Now, I've got to have time to get to the big finish, so go ahead and...
Big finish.
No, go big finish. Go big finish.
Okay, yep. Big finish. Okay.
All right.
Mid-October, all right?
Okay.
This is still going on. Pauline Combs, same lady. She's driving with her children to Broadhaven. They see this apparently a craft zipping through the sky. Now, a lot of these instances are very similar to stuff that happened in this, you know, at the Skinwalker Ranch in Utah.
Right. Okay.
Okay. She sees now. There's these huge rocks that come up out of the ocean called stack rocks, and if you Google them and see them, they're really magnificent.
It is.
They see what it looks like. A door or some kind of an opening open in the rock. This craft goes into it. Oh. The door shuts.
Excellent.
And then shortly after, they see a couple of these humanoids on top. It looks as if they're climbing up out of a stair. Ugh. And then they're looking around, and then they go away.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
Now, here's the second part of the big finish.
Okay.
You figure, okay, you've got an RAF station there, right? Group Captain Brian Lemon is the commanding officer.
Brian Lemon.
At the NATO base there.
Yes.
So the researchers go and say, hey, listen, you know, we've had all kinds of, credible people have reported this strange UFO activity. Has your radar picked up anything? Well, apparently in 1977 in Wales, they weren't worried about Nazis, commies, or terrorists because they would turn their radar on at 6:30 a.m., leave it on for about 12 hours, and then shut it off for the night.
Oh.
So the invading alien hordes could come in at their leisure at night and invade Wales.
That's a very interesting observation, though, why that would be not on all the time, not manned all the time. Very interesting.
I still don't follow it, but you know, I get it. It is a big finish. It was actually a double finish.
A double finish, right.
I do have one thing I want to add. Hopefully this, technically, I can get this to work. Steve, Switchblade, I need you to listen to this.
Here we go.
Okay.
Okay, that is in Welsh, and it's translated into, have you seen the UFO, and do you know where my cow is?
Oh, wow.
I just wanted to add that cultural language.
now you're going to have to play it again so people will...
A little Rosetta Stone, you know, from Mack Maloney's military. One more time.
Now, see, that was the big finish.
Yeah, one more time.
All right, here we go. All right.
Excellent. And the Welsh language word for UFO is UFO.
Interesting. It's the shortest. Aren't they the ones that have like really long words
they
or
do.
Something?
Yeah. And it's very, very lyrical. Gaelic and Welsh, that particular, very, very lyrical, very pretty language.
I just can't imagine that place being anything but just dreary all the
time. Oh,
I
disagree completely.
No.
I think it's a phenomenally just gorgeous place. Absolutely gorgeous place.
Oh, hey, Switch. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Okay. Oh, my pleasure.
Everything okay up there in Conflictville?
It's beyond wonderful.
Beyond wonderful.
Although we did have a clown report over in northeast of Detroit.
You know what? He's bookending.
At a car wash.
Detroit.
At a car wash.
Well, that's really unusual. And what was the activity of the clown at the car wash?
Well, the photograph I saw, he's just standing there hanging out. So
like someone who worked there. Yeah,
maybe he wipes down your window after you're done.
I'll never wash my car again because one clown's been spotted. Anyway, well, thanks for that clown report to put a period at the end of your sentence.
Yeah. Boom.
And we'll see you next week.
All right. Sounds good.
Switchblade.
Steve Wood up there in
Battle Creek, Michigan, you know, where they make all the cereals. Everything. Every cereal in the world is made up there, as it turns out. Post, Kellogg's.
At least all the ones that matter.
Right, right.
I wonder if they ever had a cornflakes explosion, you know.
Yeah, sure.
Let's not be joking about the cornflakes explosion. Mm-hmm.
Hey, well, you guys, come on.
A lot of intensity here tonight. A lot of intensity.
Yeah, a lot of kind of bad vibes in the room.
It's because he has to be the handsomest person in the room. You know, like his good looks weren't enough that we had to acknowledge it once again.
Now we're at the bottom of that black hole, and there's the socks again.
The socks are being shown again.
Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we take an ad and get everyone, you know, back on the beam, let's say. You're listening to Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. We'll be right back.
America has lost World War III. Terrorists control the countryside. Air pirates rule our skies. The United States is no more. But just when it seems like freedom is a thing of the past, a new hero emerges from the ashes. A true American who stands up for what's right. A fighter pilot who can defeat any foe, anytime, anywhere. He is the Wingman. Follow the adventures of Hawk Hunter, the Wingman, as he fights to revive the idea of America. Through 17 action-packed books, Hunter battles all those who would tread on old glory. In the air, on the sea, or on the ground, his dream is to put the United States back together again and get laid a lot while he's doing it. For some of the greatest aerial action you'll ever experience, strap in and hold on. Wingman by Mack Maloney. Now available for Kindles and Nooks on Amazon.com.
Sky Club tells the story of a spaceman deserted on a faraway world, comforted in his final days only by a music device containing his favorite music to remind him of home.
Take the children and yourself and hide out in the cellar. By now the fighting will be close at hand.
Walk on the ocean, step on the stone. Flesh becomes water, wood becomes bone.
Thousands of years later, his remains are discovered by an alien race, and from his belongings discover something called music.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me running? Can you hear me running? Can you hear me calling you?
Sky Club, a self-titled CD with Mack Maloney, contains these songs that gifted an entire civilization with music.
Somebody tell my mama if I die.
Each CD comes with a lavishly illustrated booklet chronicling the life, death, and rebirth of the space traveler. A must-have for any music lover. Sky Club with Mack Maloney. Available now at Amazon and on iTunes.
Rain on my face.
Back at Mack Maloney's Military X-Files show here on the Distant Thunder Radio Network. This is Mack Maloney in the studio with us tonight. Very famous and handsome.
Beautiful and handsome.
Whoa, Cobra. Did you just hear him say beautiful?
And handsome.
Wow.
Same breath, no pause.
Well, the word beautiful now is sort of an androgynous.
So I guess we can make it bellow. Oh, now we're going to get into his metrosexual side of
beautiful
one.
Excellent. Ways. Absolutely.
What is metrosexual? You having sex in the back of a cab, a taxi, or something?
On the metro.
On the metro. Oh, that's
in the metro of D.C.
He has a certain urban chic.
He does, yeah, right. He does have that urban chic.
I'm not an Uber guy, though, yet. Not really.
No. Uber the cab driving thing? Who would get into a car with a perfect stranger? I don't know. At least a cabbie, you know that this is what he does, you know? Who would do that? And then people go, oh, someone got beat up, someone got robbed. Well, no kidding.
Shocking that this could have possibly happened.
Anyway, we're back. Commander Cobra is here with us as well.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening, Commander.
And I think we're all clowned out.
Yes, we are.
All clowned out.
Yeah, the show is exhausting today.
But it was, but
in a good sense, in a good
orange fuzzy hair kind of way.
Yeah.
And you know, before I forget, I didn't mean to insinuate that Bozo the Clown was an alcoholic. I get a couple letters about that. You know, I didn't really mean to.
Well, it's like Krusty the Clown on The Simpsons.
Maybe I was misremembering. Yes,
I think about Krusty.
Yeah, I think Krusty was a cheap shot at Frank Eberusch, our local.
No, maybe local I thought of, I thought.
Do you think Krusty is a takeoff of that? Of Frank Eberusch?
It's an exact takeoff on really? Bozo the Clown. I mean, it's my God.
Like the police sergeant is a takeoff on one of the Kennedys?
Sorry, Bozo. I just wanted to go on record saying I'm sorry, Frank Eberusch. I didn't call you a drunk. I just thought you were, what is it? Crunchy the Clown?
Krusty
yeah. on The Simpsons.
Yeah. And every episode he just drains an entire bottle in like 10 seconds.
And has a kind of a Frank Sinatra kind of thing at the end. It's classic.
Smoking the cigarette.
It's the longest running sitcom.
Television program, period.
Yep. Yeah, it's been on.
It started out with the Tracy Ullman show.
Yep.
I remember when they were just a little short on there, and that's what started.
And look, let's face it, it doesn't take any money to put it together. Whoever is,
And the cast of people that have showed up for that show is just unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
And when I think of the voice of Lisa Simpson, that actress being on
she was on Seinfeld
Maximum,
every once in a while.
And she was on Maximum Overdrive.
Okay.
She was the crazy just got married wife that, oh no, they're coming to get us, oh, get me out of here.
Yeah. Wow, man, he did that very well. Hang on.
Maximum Overdrive. Thank you.
Okay. We're seeing new depths in the Juan-Juan catalog that we did not know.
I can't remember her name now who plays the voice of Lisa.
$10,000 worth of sound effects, and that's the applause.
Whatever. She's great. She's been doing it like a bit.
Well, that's what I mean. When they have grown out of their roles. And
you would think, but no.
30 years.
No.
That's what happens when you do a voiceover thing like that.
Oh. Anyway. Cobra.
Yes, sir.
This is your.
We have three
your moment to shine.
We have three little tasty tidbits tonight for the conspiracy files. Okay. One that just recently popped up: a series of satellites that were put up by the French in 2013 have been suffering from outages, and this problem has extended. This is a low Earth satellite array that they have, and what people take for granted now when you pick up your phone, the satellite net and the use of satellites for GPS positioning as well as the telecommunications, but to affix the position on the surface of the Earth is critical. And we know that there are GPS jammers. I dealt with them in Iraq. They keep showing up. We know, like cybersecurity, this is going on.
They jam the GPS satellites?
Yeah, they'll jam the signal so that your aircraft or you get a degraded capability. It may not knock it out completely, but if you don't have sufficient number of satellites, your accuracy goes down. So if you're in an airliner, you can't rely on it to be your only source to get to the runway.
System redundant?
It is redundant, but you have to be able to see in the sky, in your aircraft, in your car, with your phone, a certain number of satellites.
Wow.
Is it at least three? Is that how it works?
It's at least three to actually get the network going, but you need to be in the range of 13 or 14 satellites to get the really accurate position.
Really?
And there's a large move, and the reason I bring this up tonight, because I believe there's a little more than the explanation that's being passed out tonight, there's a little more going on here, because now we're getting to the point where the accuracy is getting so high that instead of using a ground-based radio to affix something like altitude, you get an altitude from GPS, but it's not accurate enough to fly an approach like in the weather or at night to a runway. They're getting very close to providing an accurate altitude. What that means now is you could go to any airport and establish your own approach in bad weather and fly to any airport, and you wouldn't need ground-based radars and stuff like that to do that. Right. Now, for commerce and for military operations, you can obviously see how critical that is. Also, what a vulnerability that it is.
Right.
So the explanation that's been bantered around is that we have thunderstorms very high in the atmosphere, and they're upsetting the ionosphere. And it's interesting because when I did a cursory look, this explanation doesn't show up too often. Maybe some listeners will write me and say, you know, Commander, you need to expand your search here and, you know, get a clue. Make believe like you did graduate from a Massachusetts school system earlier back. But I could not find anything.
Number one in the country.
Yeah, number one in the country. I did not find a lot of...
So are we talking about thunderstorms at the edge of space?
You're right. They're going up to the edge of space, putting out enough electricity that's blocking some of the signals that's causing this GPS jamming. It seems a little weak to me, and it seems amazing.
That sounds plausible. Why would
how high? What's the edge of, isn't it like 100 miles up?
Yeah, and I've never heard of these storms extending higher than like 50, 60,000 feet. So I have to do some more look in this one, but it really caught my attention.
Wow.
The next one, again, in our close proximity interstellar capabilities, is once again, NASA has attracted the attention of the Cobra with their turning off the signal when something unusual seems to show up on the feed. Now, NASA runs from the International Space Station pretty much continuous feed, and there is no less than probably 30 or 40,000 people at any given moment watching this feed live, just looking.
And the feed is of what? Is it one of the space stations?
Outside the space station.
Okay.
Yeah. It's on it NASA has a channel.
Somebody has a channel, and there's stuff you can find on the internet. Yeah. It's very interesting. And it's
just watch it.
You can see the Earth, the sun rise against the Earth, and it's all... But two or three times in the last 18 months, things have popped up, and of course you get this immediate, it's space debris, it's a particle, it's anything but what the UFO community claims. Right. Aha.
Yeah.
This last one, aha, it's got some interesting pictures. You can see them. It's got a triangle shape. We all know my fascination with the triangle shaped aircraft. And if we had in the past. But what I'm drawing the comment tonight is, how come the feed always just seems to shut off
right at
when
that
this
moment.
Comes up, when someone makes the aha claim, and it's never that we shut the feed off. It just broke. It's like your cable company. Look, we do our best, and sometimes it doesn't work.
Okay, ask one question. Now, what we're talking about is that guys on TV up in the space station, you know, looking down on Earth, and they watch them on TV. Okay. Do they, when this happens, do they request, hey, listen, we have to go off air? Or is it like, oh my God? And then
it seems more like the oh my God when you read these people, because they see it. People, of course, recording it. They're digitally recording all the time. And this one guy that just put out the footage has this blue light in the distance. He got a number of frames. He had pretty decent collection, so he did some work to show what it is. I don't completely agree with the analysis that it shows a craft. I'm just saying that this is not like just once in a while. If you were to draw the Venn diagram, a Massachusetts school reference here, the intersection is NASA keeps turning off the feed when something interesting shows up and then says that you didn't see anything here, folks. Move on to the next thing. Oh, look at the pretty star. Yeah. And off we go. So this is definitely worth tracking. And
can I ask a question?
You can ask all the questions.
I hate to be the bucket of cold water, but...
No.
All right, let's say something is seen by the space station, okay?
Right.
Isn't that, in fact, going to be seen by, NORAD and China NORAD and Russia?
Okay, so again, draw another Venn diagram. Who's controlling all that? Those are all world governments that would probably be suppressing any information
that's
going on.
They all wouldn't be suppressing it at the same time.
Oh, Bull. Absolutely bull. I can't believe somebody says that they're an X-Files.
The entity that's pulling the plug has to be on the transmission side.
No.
Right?
NASA is seeing it, and when something shows up that they don't want on the screen, they're killing the feed to the internet and into their channel. It's still being seen.
I understand. Right.
I'm going to have to break up a fight.
So it's going
to
end
up on the cutting room floor.
This went wrong with Louisiana.
I cannot. Sure, it went south of Louisiana. No pun intended.
A technical handle on what this is happening at NASA, at ground zero of NASA headquarters before they feed
someone
it out
pushes
to
a button
and kills the feed.
All right.
Like when Mac says a bad word and we can't get to the button in time. Or they we're trying to kill the feed.
Or they can capture the feed and edit the whole thing out too, right?
Yes.
But what? How long does the blackout last usually?
It varies. Wow. But it keeps coming up when you have these little teasers before it that show something. And the explanation, no, you're not seeing that. You're not seeing something there. It's space debris. It's junk. It's a meteor. It's this. And I'm happy to go along with most of this, but it's much back to if you don't want to turn this into a conspiracy, don't act like it's a conspiracy.
Right.
Rule friggin' one.
Let it roll.
And then you make me think when I go back to my deception courses and all the stuff that I was trained in the military. Rule one in deception, figure out what will make them talk and not look at what you want them to see and go staring at something else.
Right.
Hmm. I'm at the point now where I'm thinking maybe one out of every 10 of these incidents, there was something there they didn't want to see. Now, it could be technology, military technology that we don't want the world to see, which makes me wonder why we have the camera pointed that direction. But there's just something that stinks to high heaven, again, where the feed gets pulled. And I'm shocked that Juan-Juan doesn't believe that the world governments would suppress this information.
No, I believe it, but everybody has to suppress it. There's always an entity that's going to release it.
So who goes and asks the Chinese or the Russians or NORAD, oh, by the way, did you see this on Tuesday? They're not going to answer that question.
They would each country would suppress it for its own reasons. You know, it isn't like let's get together and
maybe
we've made
an agreement. Yeah. You know, in the 50s or the 60s that we're all going to go along with this because it's part of the program
and it benefits all of us. You know,
or it's mutually assured information destruction,
mutually assured stupidity.
Real quick, the story of K2 in the Nevada desert is a perfect example of this. You got Area 51, 75 miles north of Las Vegas. Okay, right. That's where they have tested everything, SR-71s, the U-2s, and a lot of stuff that you'll never hear about.
Right.
Okay, Russian satellites would go over it every day.
Correct.
Okay. They knew what time they were going over it. So they used to haul the planes into the hangar, wait for the Russian satellite.
Yeah.
You know, and then the Russians get – everyone got cameras where you could actually see where the plane was on the runway
from the heat signature.
Right, okay.
Get the shapes.
So then they had to go through all that. And basically what it was these guys are like tired of schlepping the planes back and forth. You know, this is such a waste of time. So what they did supposedly was they sent this guy out. I forget his name. And he claimed that there was a UFO base – 20 miles into the desert called S4.
Right.
And that's where all the flying saucers were held. And, you know, they were testing flying saucers and this and that. And there's a little, you know, and it's in Papoose Mountain. And they let the story out through a station in Las Vegas. This guy, he said, I worked there. I saw the aliens.
I saw it very clandestine. I worked on the ships, the whole nine yards.
Yet he's being interviewed by everybody. Okay, he goes to Japan, makes like $1 million. And, you know, this, you know, and the story's like kind of weird and people are, you know, escalating him. It was all really kind of strange. Okay. But the Russians changed their satellite schedule, and now they're going over this place five times a week or something. And they left the guys at Area 51 alone. They said, phew, now we don't have to, you know, move them freaking aircraft so much.
And it's just not not our military. Terrorist training camps know they track satellites via the internet. They know when they come over the top. You know, they blow the whistle. Everybody runs into their tents so that you don't get numbers and stuff on them.
Hey, excuse me. This is a Red Bull, right, gentlemen?
Yeah.
It is a Red Bull. We can confirm from the bunker that he is drinking a Red Bull.
Okay. All right.
So the last one we're going to bring up in our waning moments here, it really has got my ire up pretty good.
Go ahead. We have plenty of time. We'll knock on a few commercials for you to
All right. Well, the Pentagon paid for the fake Al-Qaeda videos.
This is excellent.
This is excellent.
Great story.
Yeah, this is once again, Washington now becomes Hollywood on the Potomac.
Yeah.
Now, I've sat through in my my career in the military a number of the days when they made the films. Juan-Juan, you probably remember them.
The Reefer Madness?
Reefer Madness wasn't a government film, but you remember all your training films, how to behave when you were on shore leave.
The command of the finger. What's going on?
Yeah, where Reefer Madness fits into the government military stuff. But, it's not unknown that we've had the largest number of movies produced is by Washington. Everybody else combined doesn't come close to the
training
documentaries,
films, propaganda
training
films,
propaganda, all the other stuff that goes on.
Sure.
And it's continued on there. And, of course, the age that we live in, the manipulation of social media, obviously, if you've seen the movie Wag the Dog, there's more truth in that movie than most people want to give credit.
It's basically they start a war on one scene from a news broadcast.
Right, because of an inappropriate thing that happens. They need this war thing to cover up the foolishness that's gone on Pennsylvania Avenue. So they create everything, musical scores. they come up, they build the whole record. It's a great movie. The greatest line in that movie is... When they're talking about Saddam Hussein, and the guy who's the producer of these great black projects goes, "Saddam Hussein, don't get me started. We found him doing dinner theater in upstate New York." So we have, on a more serious note, a number of movies that showed Al-Qaeda terrorist beheadings and just very abject activity that's going on being produced as claimed by a British firm that was hired working out of Camp Victory in Baghdad. I'm here to tell you, I spent a lot of time in that part, but never saw any, never heard any of this.
The sandbox.
But what drives me absolutely ape, over this crap is the money that we're dumping into this. And it's like these guys we don't need fake films with these ass clowns are doing. These people are they make enough of it on with their crappy phones. Just reboot that stuff up if you want to make the point. You have to go out and make movies of showing this stuff.
These are all actors playing
the parts, working the stuff up going forward. I mean, this is
who's playing the beheading victims?
Here's the thing is that that someone went into like the Washington D.C. variation of a pitch meeting.
Yeah,
said
we need better than what ISIS, what Al Qaeda is doing.
Here's the problem: we don't like the way their cinematography. We don't their depth, their motion.
Their depth of field sucks.
Right,
and they're not. They don't get the sun in the right position, and you can't see the victim's face long enough.
So what we're gonna do.
Is we're going to go out and make the right kind of terrorist film.
We can fix this in post, though.
Right, in post up. Very good.
They don't do a good job in the cutting room floor
Where's the green screen crew?
Yeah.
Yeah, and taking nothing away from the suffering that these ass clowns have caused on that. And then we do get to snicker a little bit on this one. But
what they do with the
God,
fake films? They distributed them out?
They distributed them out. They paid them out. They were putting in there. And I can't figure out if this is to maybe raise support. Look, Bush at 2006 for the surge took it on the chin and went. And I like him, hate him, whatever. That one turned that mess around. Firsthand, I was there, witness to tell you that worked. We didn't need to be spending money on this crap. I could have used this money to get the vote out in Iraq. I could have used this money to do better policing in Iraq, not make up movies of the atrocities that were going on around.
You know what I think, too? There's so much money around there. Didn't they, send an airplane literally full of, $4 billion in cash? And it just went away.
Yeah.
They never, no accounting.
Not like what we just recently dropped to Iran, but that kind of
a lot of extras were being used to.
Yeah, they're doing? They were basically bribing the tribes over there to, not
to
fight
join the cause, get on the right side of this thing, and sit down and make nice. And here's the paycheck to get everybody to do that.
But you knew it was fake because the ISIS militia.
No, don't confuse Al-Qaeda and ISIS. This is pre-ISIS. Okay. Or Daesh.
I'm ready.
They're all alike after a while.
Yeah. You knew the difference.
Instead of... I didn't know the difference. Instead of riding around in Toyota pickup trucks, they were using Mazdas. So right off the bat, you knew there was a...
You're saying that our technical details.
Yeah, that's right.
It must be hard to get
the
technical
advisor.
The technical advisor of Al Qaeda How do you recruit them?
The accuracy advisor was asleep with the switch there.
Yeah, no one will notice.
Look, we do a lot of stupid stuff. This one ranks up there. And when I think of what all the crap that's going on at the VA, the problem with our kids coming back that can't get adequate care. I got a family friend who's, you know, these kids just getting back on that. BS. I call the BS on this one. This crap drives me nuts. The only thing that would make me happy is if I could connect that idiot Roundtree to some of this shenanigans and get him on another piece.
I thought I'd see.
Well,
him
you
got to
follow the money. Who approved the budget? What committee did the budget come from?
Follow the money. No one's going to pay attention to this money.
Can remember that woman, a friend in the UK that we talked about earlier?
Yeah, Allison.
Yeah, Allison, and her question. We got like 2 minutes, but I want to get it in. Something that we've had before, she wrote to us, and she said, ever notice that when people see, a lot of times when people see a UFO, everything around it gets quiet.
Yeah.
And you hear that over and over and over again, like nature itself
stops.
Right.
You know?
I don't find, and you and I had both corresponded with her on that. This reminds me of a lot when you talk about the supernatural and people talk about the room. Going cold, and they talk about the energy that's being drawn out of it to go with that. I think in this case, I don't know if it's an energy draw as much as I can tell you when I step out on the compound up in Maine, and everybody's chirping and everything's happy. When it goes quiet when I'm walking back from there,
not so much.
Yeah, I go quiet very quickly myself and start sniffing the air and trying to figure out why is not all the happy insects and little birds talking at night. What's around me that's stopped this? And
well, creatures are talking at night.
Yeah.
So you don't always hear them.
But see, at night, the thing is when people say everything went still, especially at night, aren't we genetically engineered to hear better at night?
Oh, yeah. Your oral sense completely takes overrides everything. And it makes
Did he say oral sense?
He said oral sense.
A-U-R-A-L. But you can give me a little
ksh. Not just
I just keep 10, track. Juan's got like 5, and I got like 1 tonight.
I got that many?
Yeah, because you're handsome, and I'm not.
You can't overdo
this. I have a face for radio. You have a face for TV, apparently.
Can't overdo this, but who's this for?
Allison.
Earl.
This is for Allison. That
$10,000 worth of sound effects.
That's up in smoke. Do. Almost like we're making Al-Qaeda movies here tonight.
That's funny, you know? And, you know, just some guy just said, yeah, man, I talked them into making Al-Qaeda movies. I'm going to make millions of dollars. And he probably did.
Well, to wrap this back up on Allison, because we had moved into that, thank you for the writing us and keeping track. And we have discussed it.
And it's like it happens so often. It must be just a side effect of, you know, UFOs showing up. Who knows what? You know,
maybe. Or any kind of anomaly that's going on. Nature, I think, reacts to it because it's in tune with it a heck of a lot more than we have become.
You're more in tune with the natural energy of the physical Earth, and which creates a lot of the environment and weirdness that we see.
Mm. Like weeds, you mean, coming up through the ground?
Yeah. It's all about energy.
And you know what kind of weed I'm talking about?
Yeah, I knew exactly. That's why I had made that face in the bunker over here.
Pick up and put in a bag and take the bag and...
Okay.
And that creates its own special kind of silence.
All right.
Oh, I was going to say, put it out to the trash on Wednesday.
All about the weed.
Hey, listen, that's the show tonight there.
That's it.
Boys.
It's a wrap.
All right. Okay. We talked to Switchblade. About UFO flap in Wales with Dr. Rob Beckhausen. Try to talk him into coming up and visiting us sometime. That
to
would be
see
wild.
The leaves.
You know, we'll leave him in the jail somewhere, you know, without a penny. But he'd have a really good time. Who else did we talk to? What was that?
We talked amongst ourselves.
Talked amongst ourselves a lot. You two almost got in a fight twice. Had to do it with Louisiana and Mississippi. They're still not looking at each other. No eye contact. Very awkward. Mm-hmm.
That's why I'm in the bunker, apparently.
Yeah, so
the nun said it when I was a young, and I generally played well with others and occasionally ran with scissors, so I guess she summed my whole career right there.
Did you ever play paper, rock, scissors?
No, never heard of it up here. Did
never
you?
Heard of it.
Oh, yeah.
We used to buck up.
We did that, too. Buck up. Odd, even.
Right, yeah. Paper, now I see that in paper, movies and TV, rock, and I say, well, what are you talking about? You know, never. I still don't know the rules.
Rock smashes scissors.
That's right.
Paper wrapped paper. Rock.
Yep.
Hey, listen, let's wrap
scissors
this up.
Cuts paper. Scissors,
okay. Cuts paper. Thanks for joining us, everyone out there. And until next week, this is Mack Maloney for 1-1 and Commander Cobra saying be safe, be happy, and
play more hopscotch. Good night. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Okay, Kevin, for the grand prize of $1 million, what color is the White House?
I know this.
5 seconds.
Oh, switching to Geico could save you a bunch of money on car insurance?
Okay. Judges? That's true, Kevin. They'll allow it. Congratulations. You're a winner.